call the regular city council meeting for Monday, July 16, 2018, to order. We will start with our opening prayer. Mitch, would you give that for us, please?
Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day and the blessings you give us each and every day. I thank you for each one gathered here tonight, concern that they have for our city. Pray that you give us the wisdom and guidance to make decisions, to make wise decisions. I pray, Lord, that you watch over and protect us all. Bless our families, bless our community. Help us to love each other as you have loved us. We just lift that prayer in Christ's name.
Amen.
Welcome everyone to the council meeting. I hope that it will be informative to you. We will start with Chief Hall. Do you have some presentations to make?
There is. Brother Leather. CPR on him and continued until the ambulance got there. Once he's loaded on the ambulance, they swapped and I believe Officer Scoggin was in the ambulance at that time until the ambulance got ready to leave. And then they swapped again and Corporal Griffin took over for the ride to the hospital. While en route to the hospital, they regained a heartbeat and a pulse. The man's son came by wanting to commend him for saving the man's life. And I want to present him with life-saving commendations and the service bars for their uniforms for life-saving. And it's without a doubt that through their quick actions and their dedication to their fellow human being, they saved a life that day. They're a fine example of the officers that we have serving the city of Jasper and the Jasper Police Department. Citizens should be proud of them. They do an outstanding job. Many times they take ridicule that majority of the public don't even know about, and it's just, I'd like to say it's an honor and a privilege to work with them.
From the San Marino Municipal Power Agency, that best boards and department members. We have one person who has signed up on the public comments. I would just say that at this time, when public comments are made, be they good or be they bad, we're not at liberty to debate or respond really other than say thank you very much for bringing the good news, the bad news, or the indifferent news to our attention. So with that being said, Mr. Hadnob, would you like to come forward, please?
I just want to talk about the situation on Hydro Road. I talked with Zane and Sean. Wade, we have a bad situation up there with on our road that has been ongoing for years. And we haven't been able to get anything done about it. I was standing here in 2015, 3 years ago. Told that we were going to get our road, something done, followed. It's been 3 years, we haven't got anything done yet. Now, our roads are in terrible shape. We got potholes, and when it sprinkles, they come up and patch them with sprinkles. Tar, it runs out, don't stay in there long. And then you got a big sand bed up there. Rains turn into a mud puddle. And we've been trying to get something done for that road for about 3 years. Now, the county paved that road for us over 20 years ago. And Mr. C. Sales, he didn't know. When he put me over the road, he said, "Don, if anything happened to this road, let me know." So we had nine smooth paved road until about 6 or 7 years ago. Log trucks come down through there and they haul logs down through there for 3 months, which it wasn't equipped for that. And I called the police station and I told them about it. And they said it wasn't nothing they could do about it. But that was years ago. And they were finna haul logs up there a couple of months ago, and I called Chief Hall. And I told him, I said, "Chief, they finna start hauling logs out there. The road is already in bad shape now, and it's not gonna be able to stand it." And he got with me, and he brought some signs, some weight-limit signs up there. And I wanna thank Chief Hall for doing that. He brought some weight-limit signs up there, and he stopped the log trucks as they start to haul logs down our road itself. And now we got our weight limit signs, and he stopped all of that. And all we need to do is get our road fixed. And he's keeping the log trucks and the water trucks that goes up in there. He's taking care of all that business for me. She's been up there, Michelle has been up there, I believe Denise has been up there. And we've been paying tax for 20-something years. And I've said this at the last time I was down here in 2015, and all we got was a garbage can. And it may not seem much, but we pay less taxes to the county, and they pay. Now we can't get nobody up there to do the chip and seal. I mean, it's bad. You get ready to come down the road. If it ain't the potholes, it's the mud puddles. You got 10 by 20 yards worth of dirt in the middle of the road up there. And it's supposed to be paved. They used to come out with a backhoe and dig the, they dig all the gravel up. And all they need to do is put some, bring some dirt back in there and build that road back up. And then chip and seal. And that's all we're asking. I don't think that's too much. We're taxpayers, and I think we need to get something done.
Well, I appreciate you bringing that to our attention. I do know, responding, not only to you, but to the public, it's my understanding that there is a schedule of roads to be, I think what they are going to try to do is do the chip seal. Excuse me, because that's something the city can do.
Yes, sir.
But it's my understanding there is, and I'll certainly check with Greg and things about that. I appreciate you.
Okay, I appreciate you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. We'll go to action item number one. Consider approval for the minutes, approval of the minutes from the May 14th meeting.
Make a motion to approve.
Have a motion and second for the approval of the minutes from the May 14th meeting. Are there any questions, comments? If not, all in favor signify by the usual sign of voting. Motion carries, it's unanimous. Item number two, consider an invoice from Gulf Coast Strategic Highway Coalition. Ms. Kelly.
Mayor and council members, this is an invoice that we share with Jetco. The invoice was $2,500. Our portion of it is $1,250. This is still the same thing that we've done. It supports the Highway Coalition to improve our highways and Highway 14. So we're just something I bring to you every year for permission to pay.
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
Have a motion and second for the payment of the invoice $1,250. Questions? Not all in favor signify by the usual sign of voting. Carries unanimous. Item number three, ordinance 61818, amend chapter 16 regarding junk motor vehicles.
Although the Texas local government code allows the penalty up to $500, I chose to go with the lesser, which is $200, which is through the Texas transportation code. This is a class C misdemeanor. It does not go on the record per se. It would go to court. We would still give them the 10 days allotted to get rid of the vehicle before an actual citation would be issued in accordance with our local ordinances. And then at that point in time, the judge has, he sets the price. We don't, that's up to $200. Judge dismissed it. He can go $50. He can go for the full $200 for the fact that they just flat neglected it. And then order the vehicle. But that's what this order is for, is to put some of the burden back on the property.
Think $200 is sufficient incentive to get them to?
Yeah.
do something with it?
I chose to go with the minimum, but if the council wishes, we could go with the Texas Local Government Code of Fire.
There's nothing uglier and nothing that depreciates their neighbors' property values worse than having junk cars up on blocks or just rock through the pavement.
It can be per day.
Gary, can I ask a question? Is there anything about the owner of the vehicle?
Basically, it's a property owner. If someone has a vehicle on their property, they can have it removed. There's an avenue in the Texas Transportation Code that they can follow, and they can seize the vehicle and have it towed.
Property owner situation, what I envision a problem is a landlord-tenant situation where the tenant may leave the vehicle there. Landlord is getting paid, but uses inside the vehicle. Will this be against the landlord, against the owner of the premises versus the owner of the car?
It would be to the property owner, but as I stated just a moment ago, we've worked with some already and showed them the process that they can get the vehicle. Basically, they become the owner of it, they can have it towed. And it's a relatively quick process. And if that be the case, we would work with them to let them follow that and get it out of there. It's gone.
Is this an ordinance that you've taken from something else? And I'll tell you what I'm going to is, one of the determinant factors here is that it's a public nuisance, and that seems to be a bit subjective.
Yes, sir.
You know, who determines?
In the Texas Transportation Code, it is listed as a public nuisance.
But I mean, does it have to be on the street, in somebody's yard? Is it just something that's visible from the street? I mean, what determines, you know, what is a public nuisance and what constitutes a violation of the ordinance?
From a code enforcement perspective, it has to be visible from the street or a public way. If it is on a public way, then it falls under the police department and they can have it removed in 72 hours.
How many do we have that you began to explore?
Throughout the city? I don't have a count of the vehicles, but there's quite a few of them.
So who determines? Well, I guess who drives around and determines that this is junk car?
My staff does, and I do also. Always, council members and everyone in this audience.
And what is the time frame? Like you said, the owner has to remove it. I mean, what is the time frame? How many days or how many? What is the time frame? Well, you notice, like if I have a car in my yard, you talk to me, how many days do I have to do something about it? What is my time?
Typically on a junk vehicle, our first notice is you've got 30 days. That's per ordinance. It's also per the local government codes and transportation codes. And after that, then we can issue you a citation if it hasn't been removed. And it would go before the municipal judge, and he could establish the fee, whether the full amount or a lesser amount, and order the vehicle removed.
We also look at if the vehicle is registered or it's been inspected, and how long it's either one of them have been expired.
There's a list of items.
Yard ornaments.
There's a list of items that he has to meet all of those to qualify as a junk vehicle. Just because it sits there and dusty doesn't mean it's a junk vehicle. It has to qualify as one.
Any other questions? If not, I will entertain a motion.
Make a motion. Second.
We have a motion and a second for the approval of ordinance number 61818. All in favor signify by the usual sign of voting. Carries, it's unanimous. Once it's officially on the books, since it'll be there, let's, you know, it can be a full-time job for a while, but let's look at the desperate Joe Forrest.
I
almost got a balanced budget, we're just waiting on some tax information, and I have asked that we have at least by those 3 days. So we're just asking a date to have a budget workshop and a time, whether or not that y'all like it, morning, noon, afternoon, evening. We are at your pleasure as far as setting the time. We can do it as a, you know, 11 to 1 lunch meeting, you can do it 3 to 5, you can do it at 6 o'clock, it's whatever y'all want, whatever day you like.
You think it'd be more than one day?
Yes, sir. Usually when I bring it, if we work so hard to where it is at the balance, then we'll have you all the information ahead of time for you to review, and then have your questions that we'll be able to answer, or hopefully be able to answer during the meeting. And then we still have time after the workshop to make any changes that council wishes to be done.
I make a motion to set it for the 25th. 11.
I can't do that.
When are you gonna be here, Tom? When are you gonna be here? Or you have to hold it?
26.
26?
24, be good.
Okay.
Everybody?
You're okay on the 26th or Thursday?
Yeah.
Okay.
Work better for those of us working during the day would be better for during the day or the evening time?
I would vote for the day.
At 12.
Say it now.
Sir, sorry. Said, I think they indicated they would prefer during the day.
Yeah, the last 6 days, 5 days, I said, we've had like some more time.
Why don't we start at 11 o'clock then?
What day?
26.
26.
Okay, so we're gonna set for July the 26th at 11 o'clock, city council.
Watch.
Yeah, we need a motion.
Watch, because it will be. We will have a forum, hopefully a forum. We'll entertain a motion for the setting of that workshop.
I make a motion that the 26th is set for workshop.
Second.
11 o'clock. Motion second, all in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous, thank you.
Thank you.
No, the dangers.
Mayor, we have one.
Yes, one?
Go ahead.
I'm just anxious to get you up here.
Okay.
Action item number 5. David, if we could, I got you up there prematurely.
No problem.
Number 5, consider dangerous building removal order.
Mayor, council members, this is a building that has been there to the point that it actually could be considered just dangerous, and we take it out under the emergency thing, but due to the fact that it really isn't even recorded, it's an appraisal district record, I have no one to contact. But according to attorney Stephen Lee, he's done extensive research on it, and as it, all the documents that he has found gets in the trustee of the city of Casper. As you can see with the photos that I provided for y'all, it's not a good place for kids to be around, and it is in the city, just a few blocks from here. And I would like to have this building removed.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion in second for the removal of premises located in 400 block of Hale Street, known as the Lucy Coleman Shankle Estate. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by the use of sign of voting. Motion carries, it's unanimous. Thanks, sir. All right, David. Do If I don't speak loud enough, then you just have to tell me to speak louder, and I'll do my best. Most of what's on here that we've listed are potential funding sources that you as a city may choose to use for disaster recovery as it relates to Hurricane Harvey. And so, with your permission, we're gonna go through this pretty quickly. I'll ask Leslie to hand these out. Let's just start with the General Land Office program. This is really CDBG money, Community Development Block Grant money. It comes from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, and in the state of Texas, it's administered by the General Land Office. They have many different programs that could potentially affect the city, but the fact of the matter is that you, as the city of Jasper, will have control over two of those. And so on the very last sheet of paper that was just handed out, if you look at what took place by the Council of Governments, it was their job to do the regional allocation as it relates to two things. The buyout program, which is for those people who have been flooded repeatedly and need to be bought out, and for infrastructure program. Various types of drainage projects, street widening projects, all kinds of projects that you might want to do. Now, this money has been, in effect, awarded to you. You have it. So when I say to you that you have an allocation as it stands today of $1 million for buyouts and $174,304 for infrastructure, that's done. That's a fact. You don't have a contract yet with the GLO, but you will have if you choose to have one. Okay? What will have to happen is that you will go through a selection process, and we'll talk about that later. You will find an engineer, an administrator. They will put together the grant for you, and they will administer it. And if you don't use the $1 million in buyouts, you will, of course, want to say to the COG and to the GLO, how about we move that into infrastructure? Okay? So while we don't know that that's actually going to take place, this money will be obligated to you, and it can't go anywhere else. Okay? That's the way it is for right now, and that's the way it will be when you get the contract. But as far as we're concerned, we doubt seriously you have $1 million worth of buyouts to be done in Jasper. If that comes to pass, so be it. But if you don't, we'd like the money to be moved into infrastructure, because we can think of lots of projects that this money could be used for. Whether you're talking about drainage projects, like in the park, right out the window here, my favorite place to walk and to think. You're doing some improvements, the riprap, because you've got so much erosion, you've got problems. This thing drains the whole city, you see. Now, you'd have to be 51% low mod in order to qualify for that, but you are citywide. And for that matter, we have census data by block group, and you probably aren't surprised to know you don't have a single block group that's not over 51%. So you can't find a block group that's not eligible for
the. You're saying
a
what?
A block group. In other words, if I take a census tract and break it down to a smaller unit, the next smaller unit is the block group. Okay? And so typically, what I do for communities, and you probably can see it better if I hand you a copy of it. Leslie will give it to you. This shows your community, and we took the trouble to give you the census tracts, and then within those census tracts, the block groups that are within the city. And so if I say to you, well, there's not any place, basically, not any central tract that you can't go, or citywide, project citywide, you can spend money. There are plenty of places to do it. So this is going to be one of the programs that you will be offered. Actually, you'll be offered a contract. You turn in an application. So,
question.
Excuse
Excuse me, go ahead.
You talked about this money that you said was already ours, $1 million. And then you casually mentioned engineers and people overseeing our money, and I'm sure you have a fee. How does this trickle down actually to us? What do we actually get out of $1 million?
What would you get out of $1 million if you don't use it for buyouts? And I'm not being presumptuous, but if I were doing the buyouts, you would talk about perhaps a maximum of 6% for administration, and there's no engineering involved. If you're talking about infrastructure program, 6% still applies, maximum 6% for administration, and the engineering is what it is, depending on what the project is. And you can do it force account with your own.
What does engineering need to do?
Do what?
What does engineering, what can we project is going to cost us?
Well, since the engineering fee can't be more than 12%, 18% is the maximum you could spend on anything but construction.
I'm sure you have a fee.
That's included in the 18%. Okay, that's the worst it can be.
Does the money have to be used in the city limits?
Does the money have to be used in the city limits? If you went into the ETJ or had some effect in the ETJ, that's probably possible. But remember, the county has an allocation of funds itself for county projects. So you probably want to stay in the city. But where there is a potential project, let's just say you want to take Sandy Creek and do drainage improvements, and you perhaps wanted the county to do some improvements outside.
That's what I was talking about, dredging out the creek.
Sure it is. Yep.
Do we have to match any of these funds?
No, there's no match. Non-match. These are grant funds, not loan funds. Probably should have said that. And there's no match in this requirement. Okay, so when we're talking about the GLO CDBG money, this is what we're talking about, and that allocation has already been voted on by the COG and been sent to the state. So we pretty well know exactly what we're talking about. What we're not sure of is what happens to the extra money that's left in the buyout program, assuming you don't use it all. And that, we hope, will go back into infrastructure for the city. And you can see why.
Now, you say it's set aside. Is that for us or for the COG?
Say that again. I'm sorry.
You said it is already set aside for us.
Yes, that's
now,
correct.
Is that to be determined by the COG?
It's been determined. This is a fait accompli. This is over with. It's done. It's taken place. Been voted on by the board. It's all over with. There's nothing left to talk about. And if you're going to wonder, when you look at that spreadsheet, if you're going to wonder, well, there are a few cities on here, but not many. In fact, there are only three cities on there, and you're one of them. That's the way the allocation came out, and the reason it came out that way is because the state has said in their action plan that they have, hey, we're not going to do any contracts less than 100,000. So when the allocation was worked out, if you were the city of Woodville or some other city, and the allocation said 94,000, no deal. Okay, it had to be 100,000 or greater. So that's why there are only three cities on there. Okay.
I'll attribute my hesitation to being new here at City Hall.
Correct.
There's $1 million in allocated for us. What are you here asking us to do?
Well, first, what I thought I would do is to say to you, let's go through these projects and see what's available, what's these funding programs. And then what I would be asking you to do is to go through selection for your engineer and your administrator. If we do a project for you and it doesn't get approved, it doesn't cost you a nickel, nothing. So we're not asking you to put up money, but you can't do the work unless we're approved by council to do the work, and unless you go through a proper procurement process.
Okay, so what we're talking about here is the potential projects that are out there, the money that's out there that you have a chance to get, some of which you really already have. Okay?
Are you wanting a motion on each individual item?
I would like to make a motion. We were prepared for this. You furnished all these papers here tonight. I'd like to make a motion when we have a workshop on this, where we can look at these numbers. This is not a 5-minute piece.
Yeah.
Something we're talking about millions of dollars we need to look at, just going it over there. So I'd like to make a motion we can have a workshop.
So you're tabling it for tonight, is what you're doing?
Yeah.
David, could you possibly be available on the 26th when we're gonna have our budget workshop?
I think that's not, that's not. And it's fortuitous that we have that coming up, because a lot of these have deadlines connected to them, so it's fairly important to get through the process. The procurement process will take you a month. So, I mean, that's, if you follow the law, that's about what it takes. So I guess what I'm saying is, yeah, that would be good for the workshop, and then perhaps we can go through these things individually, which would be a very good idea, no question.
Do you have any other information that we should take and try to digest prior to?
Yeah, if you don't mind, why don't we give out to you one at a time, and I'll just mention what they are, and then you'll be able to read them at your leisure, and you may have questions. The one Leslie's giving out right now is Texas Department of Public Safety, and really what it is FEMA money, and it's for mitigation projects. Now, look, that's not Stafford Act money. In other words, it's not, I fixed a pothole that was caused by the Hurricane Harvey, and they want to give me 52 cents for doing that when it cost me $100. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about mitigation projects where you're putting in a new bridge or you're doing something else, and you're not putting it back like it was. You're putting a brand new structure in to meet current standards. So I didn't come to you here tonight to talk about Stafford Act projects. I'm here to talk to you about projects that are brand new and meet current standards. When we do a bridge, we can't put it back like it was. It's got to meet TxDOT standards. So, you know, that's the way it works, and that's the way it'll work in this program. There is another program you may be interested in also, which is coming up, and this is the GLO flood program. It's also CDBG money, and we took the trouble to give you the scoring so you could, I guess, see how you might rate. And we scored for a lot of the people that we work for just to see how they would do. And of course, there were really two things we couldn't know: the effect on the public housing authority and the leveraging, because we didn't know whether our client at the time was going to put up the 5% match money or not. But you're right, here's one that doesn't require a match, but if you don't get the points, you don't get funded, so, and you don't know who the competition is. But if you look on the sheet, you're going to be able to see how you would rate. You get 54.22 points, and you can see what you look like in relation to some other communities that also have the potential for applying for this money. That one, after you read it, I bet you do have a few questions, so that'll be good. Here is the executive summary of the Economic Development Administration. They have $129 million that they would like, and that's out of the Austin office, that they would like to spend in this area. And so there's a 60-40 match, generally speaking, on these projects. Can you use CDBG money I talked about initially to match an EDA project? Yes, you can. Been done many times before. So that's why the CDBG money is so important.
because it gets to match any other federal grant. And there's only one act under the federal law that can do that, and that's CDBG. So this executive summary will take you through what EDA is looking for. Again, they will explain it perhaps better than I can, but what I would tell you is that having talked to their people is they're looking at some type of long-term effect. So if you said to EDA, I was widening the road and I envisioned this creating jobs and this is what I'm doing, they might want to buy into something like that, just by way of example. There are lots of other examples. Certainly have done buildings for us in the past. It's certainly possible that you have an industry that wants to expand, but they need an access road from you, and you know what? You can get that access road with this money. So not something to be taken lightly, something that money's there and they're going to spend it. The question is, will you get any of it or not?
Is there a time limit on this statement? Do we have to have this approved by any certain length of time, or we stand the chance of losing it?
Well, what I'll say to you is after your 23rd meeting, we will need to conclude everything as rapidly as we can, okay? There is a time limit. We have turned in the flood projects in August. We'll work through that, okay? We'll just find a way to work through that. But these other things don't have a specific time limit. In fact, I guess I would tell you that most people with FEMA would tell you, well, the time limit is July the 25th, and that's what it was yesterday, but now they're talking about pushing that time limit to sometime in November.
Well, so we just set our meeting on the 26th, so.
I understand what you're saying.
Well, I mean, we're going to de facto cut us off.
Well, you might have to call a special meeting once you come back from the workshop. Right. August the 20th is our next meeting.
Right, and I understand what you're saying, but if you go through procurement, call a special meeting and do what you have to do, you'll be able to proceed.
Did you say August? I thought it was, you said July. When is the cutoff on that?
Okay. If we're talking about the flood program, that's due in August. Okay?
You say it takes a month. If we agree, it takes a month.
That's right. We have to do it very rapidly if possible.
If we have the workshop on July the 26th, and then we give notice 3 days or 4 days later, we would have to come back here before the end of July for a special meeting to determine whether or not we're going to approve these grants. That's the way I'm looking at it.
Well, that's one way. But my way is the procurement process says that you're going to run an ad in the paper, you're going to notify at least 5 consultants and 5 engineers. You're going to send out these requests for proposal. That's what the federal law requires, and that's what we're going to have to meet. Okay?
Well,
whoever we're working with.
I think the question that the council has is whether or not we're on a time crunch here for this money.
Well, what I say to you is we will do our very best. The flood project will be very difficult to do if we don't move ahead. The others, seems to me, we can make the timelines.
Do you have any solid deadline dates, like August the 31st? No, do you have any actual deadlines for sure? Or are they all up in the air if you don't know?
I do. September 27th is the deadline for the flood money, the 2016 flood. 27th? 27th, yes, sir. The reason we don't have any deadlines for anything else is because they keep moving as people are having a more and more difficult time getting all this information in, working with their engineers, waiting for the state to do their portion. I was told this morning that the Department of Emergency Management has hired people throughout November to help with technical assistance, and they are telling people there's going to be a extension. It's not on their website right now, but that's not unusual. So that's the best we have right now and what people are working towards.
That's what we know, and I do think I'm giving myself time enough to do that flood thing based on your meeting in July. I think we can do it. I just think we can. It'll be close, but I believe we can do it.
Well, at least get the reading.
Yeah, and I think that's a fair statement, reading it. What I've given you is an excerpt. What it comes from is huge, okay? But at least you know where the money's coming from, and you have a good idea of what it can do. Okay? And that's a good.
We might be able to figure out what we're voting.
Figure out what?
What we're voting against.
Well, actually, that really comes later, because quite frankly, you know you're putting in, or you're potentially putting in an application. But let's use Texas Emergency Management. If I look at the city and say, did you turn in any NOIs for any FEMA projects?
Working on some major dependents.
Okay, so you turned some in? Okay, well, if the NOIs, if what comes back from FEMA is, we are hereby inviting an application, that's what you do. It doesn't mean it'll be funded. We know it requires a 25% match, and you know, you use the CDBG money to match it, but that's part of the process, is putting the applications together, whatever they might be. And you finally decide on that. Even after you've selected your individual administrator, you can decide not to apply for a particular category of funds at all. And you'll be looking at the potential projects yourself, and you'll be making decisions which projects to apply.